of sentimental verse, nothing in my purse, and chuckles when the preacher said, for better or for worse,
how lovely it was. Thanks for the memory of Schubert's serenade, little things of jade, and traffic jams and anagrams and bills we never paid.
How lovely it was.
When people take pictures, they are actually making memories and sharing the happiness of times past with generations to follow. Hapeville has progressed from a village of chickens through a town of tin lizzies to a city of modern transportation. Through the memories of these longtime residents of this area, we are able to relive this period of our history.
Ms. Bynum, I understand your grandfather was an early settler in Hapeville. Will you tell us something about him?
I have a picture here of my grandfather, Mr. Edwin Alonzo Doan, and myself, taken on the front porch of my daddy's house at Capitol Avenue in Atlanta in 1910. I don't know exactly when or how or why they got to Hapeville. My mother said that one reason for the move was to help her asthma, so Hapeville already had its reputation for good air. So by the mid-80s, the four of them, Mr. and Mrs. Doan, Lonnie, and Jesse, were settled in their first house in Hapeville on Fulton Avenue. Later, I believe this house was called the Waddy House or the Reed House. I have a picture here of the schoolhouse, which was built in 1886. I wish I had listened more to the tales of the Doans about early days in Hapeville, but I do know that Grandfather left off his railroad career and became interested in civic and real estate affairs. He helped found this school when he was on the school board and was chairman of the school board in 1891. Here I have a picture of Mama, Jessie Doan, when she was 13 and was a student at school. See that hair. Here I have a letter in the same year, 1888, when she was 13, that she wrote to her mother who was visiting in Meadville. She, my mother, and her father and brother were staying with Aunt Molly and Uncle Will, who were Mr. and Ms. W.H. Betts. She says Aunt Molly, it was Miss Betts, has the best cook in the country and has to pay her $8 a month. My mother was a letter saver, even to notes from her schoolmates. In 1891, when she was 16, she and a school friend, Martha Lowe, decided to jot down some of the happenings in Hapeville and call it Hapeville Gossip. Hapeville is overrun with applicants for summer board. Every room in Miss Betts' boarding house is engaged for the summer by people who appreciate our cool, pretty little town and the delightful water that only Hapeville can supply. In 1894, my mother had finished school and was teaching piano lessons in the Hapeville Academy. Why they called her Miss Jessamond Doan instead of Miss Jessie Doan, I do not know. In 1895, the Doans helped to build Christ Church, the Episcopal Church, which still stands down on Georgia Avenue at Chestnut. The interior of the church was simple but elegant. Note the kerosene lamp, chandelier. The church had a seating capacity of 200. My mother was organist at Christ Church, and in 1901, the organ just played out, and she wrote a letter to Andrew Carnegie requesting his help in replacing it. In 1904, the Doans had two weddings in Christ Church. My Uncle Alonzo married Julia Sassnett, who lived on Atlanta Avenue near Oak Street. This is a picture of Mama when she was married in her wedding dress. Not so bad for the Pennsylvania Yankee girl who was transported to the Deep South in her early teens. My grandfather went into business with Will Lowe, who owned a large block of land, and they called the company Hapeville Land and Improvement Company. This was the first real estate company in Hapeville, and they started selling lots in the Atlanta-Fulton Avenue area. A year or so before his death in 1913, Grandfather Doane built this house on Stewart Avenue in the Moreland Way Triangle. Later it was known as the Segrist House and the Stallworth House. In this picture, my sister and I are sitting on the steps with our father and grandfather. He must have died soon after this, and I think my first memory of anything is the day of his death. He was buried in Mount Zion Cemetery, as are the other family members, including my parents. I am so happy to have had my beginnings in the beautiful little town of Hapeville.
I was born in Hapeville, Fulton County, Georgia, 1898, on Old Jonesboro Road. My grandfather was Willis Madison Cash. He moved from Amherst County, Virginia, about 4 years before the Civil War. Bought a land lot, 66, in Fulton County, which Old Henry County, which was then Fulton County, and raised his family there. On the 19th of November, 1884, my grandfather bought 25 acres adjacent to his property from a Mrs. Cornelius and Martha Skinner. He paid for it as $100 a year for 3 years. And the property is known now as part of the old Davis Cemetery, and then going southeast takes in the property owned by Miss Perry Hudson. In addition to owning the home place, he had five tenant houses and had five families that farmed the property. The reason the bad curve is in the Old Jonesboro Road is that the cemetery was there many years before the road was paved. In the area around the Davis Cemetery, which was the Cash Farm then, my grandfather plowed up several mini bowls. I still have a collection of those. In that area, there are steel ridges where the Yankees threw up breastworks. It is interesting to know that Mildred Miller, in building her home on Old Jonesboro Road, left those ridges in her yard. When I was about 12 years old, Mr. Doane passed away, and the day of his funeral, the College Street School was dismissed for the funeral. Mr. Doane was a member of the Haven Masonic Lodge, and the casket was drawn by horses and wagon to the Mount Zion Cemetery. And the members of the Masonic Lodge marched in front of the hearse, and all the school children walked behind the procession. Right after the Civil War, my grandfather was returning from Atlanta, and this little colored boy, about 12 years old, was laying on the side of the road almost starved. My grandfather brought him home, and he had a little house out in the backyard which he equipped for this colored boy to live, and he lived with the family. He was one of the best people I ever knew, never harmed any man or beast. I have a picture of the home place that was made on my grandfather's 80th birthday, and it was a celebration for his family and many friends. This picture was made June the 9th, 1891. I would like to read part of the obituary as a tribute to my grandfather. When the coffin of this old man was opened, everyone in the congregation walked up and looked, at last took a last look at him. if one can live in this wicked world for 81 years and have tears shed by those who knew him best, his neighbors, he can feel content that his life has been over, has been one that can apply. Well done, thy good and faithful servant.
I was born January the 17th, 1915, at 40 Union Avenue. An unpaved street and rolling road, muddy. And we used to follow the ice wagon when it would come, and everybody had to have a piece of ice and let it rain, and we would slide down the hill in the mud. We were always members, my family was always members of the First Baptist Church, and we were at the first little church there on the corner, and one of our brothers was the custodian, and one of his duties was to ring the church bell to remind everybody it was time to go to Sunday school on Sunday morning. We always were there on time because we would go with him so that we could swing on the rope that was ringing the bell.
Is this the church that had the baseball team?
I don't believe the baseball team that the church had was organized until late, until after the stone church was built. The different people there in Hapeville, they would have different leagues, but different churches would, and organizations. And Charles and Emerson Evans and Luke Applin and all of those people were very, very active in it, and we would follow them everywhere on Saturday, and they could never go anywhere because they had to play ball for Hapeville First Baptist Church. Well, it took me 7 years to get through grammar school. Starting in the first grade, we all went into the main building. We had one boy, that Charles Reddick, that did not miss a day in the 7 years that he was in school and not tardy. The little Episcopal church was just right up the street from us, and it was never in use that I can remember, except the ghost that lived in it. And if you would go around the church three times, the ghost would come out. He was a friendly ghost. So if we had come in, or even not company, several of us would go up and run around the church. And we'd go one time, and some of them would fall out. Then we'd run a little bit more, you know, and then another group would fall out. But the funny thing about it, nobody ever made it the third time. After 5 years of teaching, I came back to Hapeville to teach, and I taught at Hapeville High School from 1942 to 1974. So the school was very young at the beginning, and I did see it grow, the athletic program as well as the academic program. And I think that in 1974 and even now, Hapeville still has a lot to be proud of for its educational facilities.
I was born in Forest Park, Georgia, in September the 26, 1906. There were seven of us boys. Guy and Fred, there was about 3 years difference in the age, and then Hoyt, Alton, Harold, Walter, and Roy, there's about 2 years difference in our ages. Well, I went to Forest Park Grammar School, and then we went to Howard's Academy School over there about where Lake Mirror was located, close to Mr. Tom Lee's home. Mr. Joe Umphress used to be the teacher there, my mother, and Dr. Frank Wells, and Jerry Wells, and Mr. Joe Wells. A lot of the Wells family went there. And I went with Sam and Dan and Clinton Wells. I went downtown to Fulton High School in 1924. And I used to have to ride the streetcar from Hapeville all the way through East Point and West End to downtown Whitehall Street at the corner of Whitehall and Trinity Avenue. Yes, I believe most of us brothers was born with a baseball in our hands. As we played as a kid, and we had a ball diamond out behind the house when we lived on Virginia Avenue by the Churn's home property. Luke Kaplan, who was one of the great ball players that I was fortunate to play with there, he played with the Chicago White Sox for 20 years, and he's in the Hall of Fame, Baseball Hall of Fame, and he's, present time, he's a batting coach for the Atlanta Braves now. Well, we had some of the Hapeville boys was Namus Evans and Top Ellington, and of course my brothers filled in to play with us. We had Speedy Green, that I was down at Fulton. I played with Burlin Moore, Judge Burlin B. Moore's son, and Speedy Green, Cy Young, Cubie Lefkowitz, Carl King. One thing I remember when I was a small kid that I'd like to mention was during World War I, the trains used to have to stop at the depot and wait for another train coming north. And we boys would run over to McElroy's drugstore on the corner where the post office is now and buy cigarettes and chewing gum and candy for them and run back out there and hand it to them through the windows. And that was a great treat for some of us boys that stayed around the depot at that time. And I have some wonderful memories about growing up in Hapeville.
The recreation building was built in 1948. At the same time, the Fulton County Board of Education under Jerry Wells, who was superintendent of the school, was planning to build an auditorium for the high school. So the city and Fulton County Board of Education worked out an agreement to use the high school auditorium for city activities and use the recreation building for the high school physical ed classes and basketball teams. That's why in the lobby of the recreation building there's a Hapeville High Hornet design in the green and white tile. I had that Hornet design to tie in the city recreation building with the high school physical education classes. Also, inside the recreation building are two great big speakers that were used for the WSB barn dances that were held every Saturday night in the recreation building. Lucille and I used to chaperone nearly every Saturday night. Then WSB moved out. They left the speakers over the stage, and they are still there today. The cornerstone of the recreation building was laid in 1948. Perry Hudson was mayor. I built a metal box over at Delta to put inside the cornerstone. The high school Hornet paper, the Southside paper, letters from the mayor and councilman, and a number of business cards are in the box. It is supposed to be open in 50 years. That will be in 1998. Roy Brewer and the high school booster club, the Hornet Booster Club, they called it, had stands and a press box built in the east side of the football field. I suggested we build cement stands on the west side of the football field and have a brick entrance with an oval archway and a bronze plaque. The city wanted to raise some money to build a memorial to the Hapeville boys who lost their lives in World War I and World War II. So they added 15 cents to the water bill each month, and after about 2 years, they had about $11,000. It is called the Hapeville Memorial Stadium in memory of the boys who lost their lives in the two world wars. I have been on the city council for 24 years and have served under 7 or 8 mayors. Perry Hudson was the mayor when I came on the council. Then there was Gene Dixon, Rex Reeves, Herbert Timmerman, Frank Lee, Perry again, and now Frank Coggins. I have had the honor of serving with some mighty good men. I've always been interested in the Hapeville, and I appreciate being associated with getting things done for our city.
We are indebted to these people for sharing their interesting and entertaining recollections of times past. Thanks for the memories.
Thanks for the memories.
My friend, we thought they'd never end. We'd sing and dance forever and a day. Those lilting melodies that stirred our memories, those were the days. Oh yes, those were the days.
There is a compulsion in people to record the fascinating events in their lives. As we lift up our memories of the days that were, we realize that these are times that will never come again. Our memory goes gently back again and again to the ambience of things past. And we silently thank those people of dynamic character and solid values who settled in Hapeville, built their homes here, and gave us a rich heritage on which to build our future. We mourn the passing of those days. Even though we cannot return to that time, we recognize the past as a sweet, safe place to remember. Through the voices of these people of Hapeville, we look back and spend a little time remembering. Those were the days.
I was born in Atlanta, Georgia.
In what year?
May the 7th, 1908.
And when did you move to Hapeville?
In 1911.
Tell us some of your early recollections of Hapeville. What did it look like in 1911?
Well, in 1911, I wasn't very old, but I do remember that there were no paved streets, no running water, sewage, or electricity, electric lights. And I remember very well that I clean chimneys for kerosene lamps. And after, I can't remember what year, that we did get water and sewage, but it was great to have a bathtub to take a bath in. We lived at 3715 Forest Avenue. I can say that in my lifetime I have been that I lived on Forest Avenue. I have seen it go from unpaved streets with the Model T Fords to a busy city street and finally completely disappear altogether when the airport took over. And now the Loop Road Boulevard, I believe, goes through our former property. I started in the first grade at College Street School. At that time, it was, I believe the name of the school was Hapeville Elementary. And Weta Cox Wells was my dear first grade teacher. So I finished the seven grades at that school. In those days, we had fancy dresses and flowers when we graduated from the seventh grade. And we are planning a luncheon May the 22nd at the Airport Hilton for about 21 or 2 members of that class. And we are all certainly senior citizens, but we are all so excited over getting together and talking over old times. And some of the girls in the class have gone through their old trunks and found their graduating dresses. Elvina Wells is also going to bring hers, and I don't know how many more dresses will show up, but I know mine won't, because I got rid of mine as soon as possible. It was made of that organdy that just about drove me crazy for having to wear it for the graduation exercises.
Tell us something about Lake Merrill.
Well, Matt was after Dave came on the scene in 1932. Lake Merrill had opened, I believe it had just opened, and he was a great swimmer and loved the water, and we spent all of his free time, which wasn't very much because working and going to Georgia Tech took up just about most all of his time. But we did find time to go to Lake Mirror and spent many fun hours swimming in that beautiful natural lake.
I think they had several signs around there. Tell us about some of those.
Yeah, they did. They had some signs, and Mr. Lee was just a good old guy, and we sort of stood in with him. And so we just made some pictures on some of his signs that he thought were all right.
Dave, I know you've lived in Hapeville a good long while and have had an interesting career over at the airport. I'd like for you to tell us something about your work.
I came here in 1932 from the Weather Service at Bellefonte in central Pennsylvania. And of course, my career was at on the airport during all that time from 1932 to 1972, in which I was an observer in the first few years and finally advanced to district forecaster in the later years. I came down here to stay just a couple of years, then get back north, but I met one of the bells of Forest Avenue and I decided to stay. The pilot balloon shown on this picture was released twice a day, and we took readings on it with a transit, or what we call a theodolite, and that from that we computed the direction and velocity of the wind at different elevations above the ground. That was very important for aviation purposes. This picture showing this gentleman, he is actually sitting on the parapet on the second floor of the old terminal building, the one that was completed in 1932, just before I arrived. I arrived here in September 32, but that building was completed in July of 32. The gentleman is Victor Randecker, and that's one thing I failed to mention. He was a pilot for the airplane observation. This one picture is the radiosonde reports were started in 1938 at the Atlanta airport. They were about 6 feet in diameter when they were released from the ground, and they went got up to more than 15 feet in diameter, I suppose, when they got up in the upper levels of the atmosphere. The amount of information we got from the upper level investigation, we got a lot more on the radiosonde, which went up to 100,000 feet. I'd hate to think of ever leaving Hapeville here in the South, because we've had so many wonderful experiences through these 47 years, and it's just been great.
I moved into Hapeville in November 1919 on a cold, rainy day with my husband and my 9-month-old daughter, Edna. We moved in on a Tuesday, I believe, and Wednesday night we went to the Methodist Church. My husband had just been appointed as pastor to the Hapeville charge. Connected with it was Mount Zion Church up on Stewart Avenue. We went there one Sunday of month to preach. Among the Stewarts that were there and we met was Dr. W. Frank Wells. Dr. Frank Wells was our devoted friend, stayed with us as long as he lived to take care of us. Wherever we moved in Georgia, he would come if we needed him. We had good neighbors, and across the street was a lady who drew beautiful flowers and cooked lovely angel food cake. One day she said to me, "Why don't you grow some flowers?" I said, "I enjoy looking at yours, and I'm growing babies. You take care of the flowers." Another thing that I remember was an old well under the parsonage, back porch. Edna was playing, the baby was playing out there one day, and she dropped a toy through the crack in the floor. And she came and got me by the skirt and says, get it, get it. And I went to see about it, got out on my knees and looked through the crack. And instead of seeing the toy, I saw a well of water. And the floor was rotting out over it. So the next project for the parsonage committee was to get the well filled up. Brooksy, that all of you will remember, was a cute little 5x5 lady that could tell marvelous stories. One day, she was driving a big automobile. She wasn't ever a very good driver. In fact, she wasn't quite 5 feet tall. And she was driving a car. And some of the children in the back got into a fray because she had two children, Julia and Frank Jr. And she turned to see about them and ran into a telephone post. Not long after that, in Sunday school, Frank Jr. was sitting in the class, and the teacher was telling about Lot's wife looking back and turning to salt. He says, that's nothing. My mama looked back and turned into a telephone post. Frank Jr. was just a few years older than my daughter, Edna. And Brooksy and I had a good time nursing the children together. I drove for her a great deal of the time because she didn't like to drive. And whenever we needed a car, Dr. Wells would loan us the car. You remember the old trestle down over the railroad? A funny thing happened, not so funny either. Frank Jr. Wells had fallen about 6 weeks prior to that and broken one arm, and it had been in a cast. 2 days after he got it out of the cast, he was playing with boys down on the trestle. Fell off the trestle, came walking in to the house, the little brown house there on Central Avenue. With both arms dangling, he says, Mama, I broke both of them this time. I have here Mr. Barton's pastor's books for the years that we were in Hapeville. Some very interesting information telling about who was on the official board and how many people died. There's some deaths recorded here. How many people joined the church, their names, those that left the church. Our salary was $1,300 from Hapeville and $200 from Mount Zion, giving us the total amount of $1,500 a year. There was one good thing about it. Dr. Wells never sent us a doctor's bill. My memories of Hapeville are very pleasant. One of the things that I was delighted with was to have a parsonage. So this parsonage, even though it was not a mansion, was a very beautiful home to me. And I settled down there for 3 happy years. So thanks to Hapeville.
I was born in Johnson County, Georgia, Wrightsville. And my birth date was August the 10th, 1908. I came to Hapeville in February in 1927. I was looking for a job as a barber, and I heard of a job in Lowry's Barbershop, and I came out there and had a talk with a man, and he gave me a job, and that's when I started working in Hapeville.
And where was the barbershop located at that time?
It was on Atlanta Avenue. It was about the second, third door from the corner of the drugstore, and the doctor's office and the barbershop. And there was a vacant store there, which the post office had moved out of, and it moved down on Fulton Avenue across the railroad. And then Mr. Pope's store, grocery store, was next door to the vacant building. And we moved right across the street from the orphan home. And of course, the Methodist church was right up the street from there. But then later on, nearly everything moved across the tracks. And we worked over there, or I worked over there about 5 years, almost 5 years, and I bought half interest with Mr. Lowry, and we moved the barbershop across the tracks on Central Avenue. Well, when we was on Central Avenue, we stayed there for many years, and that's when Mac Cannon came to work with me, and then a few months later, Mr. Brooks came to work with me. So we had a three-man barbershop there for a long while, and all of us did well. We was making a good living and having a good time. We was going fox hunting, bird hunting, rabbit hunting, fishing. We'd close up on Wednesday afternoons, and we'd look forward to those days to go to Jackson Lake fishing and have a big fish cookout and just have a great time. And then, after I got out of the Army, I had to move the barbershop, and we moved down on Fulton Avenue in Mr. Honeycutt's building. Mr. Honeycutt had a little real estate office right side of this building that Mr. Anderson was in, and I moved in half of the building with Mr. Anderson, which was where the post office originally was.
I'm sure in all these 51 years that you have cut hair in Hapeville, there's been some interesting stories told in your barbershop and also a lot of interesting people. Tell us about some of the people whose hair you've cut.
Well, I have a picture here of a fine little boy. His name is Chip Brown, first haircut. And I got a kick out of that, and I think his father did too, because he was such a fine little boy. Get his hair cut, he acted like a big boy. Then here's another little snapshot here of two fine little boys. Said I cut that family a half for many, many years. We were starting off with John and Powell Lee. We'll say that I cut John's hair, and I cut John's father's hair and his grandfather's hair. And then we'll come back down, and then I cut John's son's hair. And these little boys here is his grandchildren that I cut their hair. So that's several generations of people that I trim the hair. Well, I enjoyed all those years in Hapeville and at the barbershop, and had some mighty fine people came in there all the time. But Hapeville been good to me, and I've appreciated everything in Hapeville.
I was born in Douglas County in 1909, and my family moved to Hapeville about 6 months later. We came by Surrey by way of Fairburn, Georgia, and Papa had rented a small house on Lang Avenue, which was the only one vacant at that time, and we stayed there just about 1 year. He found a much larger house on the corner of Caldwell and Central Avenue, and we moved there. That's where the city, where the fire station is now located. All of Virginia Park was nothing but a cotton patch and an apple orchard, and they had the best Yates apples in there of any place I've ever eaten. Now, on the corner opposite our house there on Central Avenue, it was a grove of trees, and Papa had our pig pen over there. I'll never forget that, because I remember when he went over there to kill one, and it nearly broke my heart. But anyway, we did raise a lot of hogs over there until they built a house on that corner, and that did away with our hog pen. On across the railroad, there didn't have anything over across the railroad, and so finally the Standard Oil Company built three huge storage tanks over there, and we watched that grow. We watched Hapeville grow considerably while there in Hapeville. Now, we kids did not have to have a lot of entertainment. Hapeville put up a city light and put up a street light right in front of our house, And that was our entertainment at night. The children in the neighborhood got under that light, and we played under that light until time to go to bed. I never will forget the time that the schoolhouse, which is presently known as the College Street School, burned down. Now, believe it or not, but we could see the flames from where we lived, and that was the most terrifying thing for me. I just bent over double with my stomach. It just made me sick to see those flames. But later on, after the school burned down, well, they had to make places for the to go to school, and so the Methodist Church and the Baptist Church and the Episcopal Church, which is located on the corner of Georgia Avenue and Chestnut Street, opened the doors for them to have classes. Now, before I went to school, I went when I was 5 years old, but I told them I was six. And so I went down to the school there on, in the Episcopal Church, and that is now remodeled into a home, and it's still standing today. And we went into to the main building there at College Street after it was rebuilt. And I never will forget the time when we'd have, before we'd go into the school early in the morning, they'd have the Victrola playing. And they'd play Stars and Stripes. And then at recess time, when we'd go out, well, they'd start having that that Stars and Stripes. But we would line up and go in. Now, across the street from the College Street School was a vacant lot. And that's where we would play in the during recess times. Papa liked Hapeville so much, he wanted to buy him a house. And so he and Lynn, my brother-in-law, went over on Fairview Road, and they had just cut, well, they had cut this road, and but it had not been developed very much. Only two or three houses were on there. And so he bought a lot, and Lynn bought a lot, and they built the houses there on Fairview Road. And then they renamed the street to be Whitney Avenue. Went to work while I was living there, and I met my husband and was married there in the house. We watched the Presbyterian Church build their church next door to us, and they were lovely people, and we enjoyed living there. And they had the bells on the church, I guess you'd call it bells, but we loved to hear that music. And my life there on Whitney Avenue was really happy. And the airport had grown so much, and every time they'd have an air show, everybody from Atlanta and every place else, they would come to Hapeville, and it was just one car after another that would be coming all the way from Atlanta to the airport. And I remember when Lindbergh, when he landed over there, and we would stand on the sidewalk, hoping sometimes they'd cross the railroad to go across on the other side, but most of the time they would come on out of the side that we were, and we'd get a glimpse of the car, that's about all, but we'd be waving everything. Mother and Dad, they were living there at the Honeycutt House on Central Avenue. They'd been living there for about 3 or 4 years, and so they wanted us to come up there and live. Times was getting real hard, and the Depression was entering, and so we moved, and we had about two or three rooms with them, and we lived there until after Mother passed away, and then we bought that house from Dad Settle and remodeled it, and we lived there on Central Avenue for around 25 years. And then over on the corner next to us, it was Everhart, I believe that's the name of it, automobile place. However, before Everhart, that was a great big house which Ms. Kimberly, Eugene Kimberly, had, and then after that was Dr. Barron, a chiropractor, had his place there. But then later on in years, well, this Ms. Brandon rented this house next door to us, and she had this Brandon Funeral Home. I want to say that was a real happy time to be connected with Ms. Brandon. She was a lovely person, and we were great neighbors there. And then later on, Brandon came to be Brandon Mitchell Funeral Home, and I think everyone is acquainted with Ms. Dorothy French. She was Ms. Albert Mitchell, and they were, she's just like a sister to me, even now. We just love each other. And then after that, well, we so, well, Donahue took over then, and it became, I believe, Brandon Donahue. It had been Donahue Funeral Home. I've watched the city of Hapeville grow from a one-horse town to a thriving, beautiful city. It's grown by leaps and bounds, before the city of Atlanta took in part of our city. I have lived in Hapeville for 70 years, and although I am not presently living in Hapeville, I still feel that Hapeville is my home and will always be. When anybody tells me or asks me where I'm from, I say I'm from Hapeville because that's where my heart is, and I will always love Hapeville, and I appreciate the many memories that I have of Hapeville.
This is G.D. Adams. When I let my memories live again, I can dream of the old days. Life was beautiful then. I was born on Lakewood, corner of Lakewood and Stewart Avenue in the Lakewood area, and many of my friends lived in Hapeville. I recall the happy times I had in growing up here in the early 1900s. My father had a grocery store with gas pumps in the front, the kind you pump by hands, located on the corner of Stewart and Lakewood Avenue. Many of his customers lived in Hapeville, and I delivered groceries to them when I was only 13 years old. Stewart Avenue was the only paved road around Hapeville at that time. One of my favorite forms of entertainment was when racing automobiles up the Mile Hill. The races would start at the bottom of the hill where Nally is now. Then up the hill they would go toward Lakewood Avenue as far as they could go in high gear. I think Pat Murphy was one of the racers, and Willie B. Adams was one of the most faithful regular spectators. This was main entertainment for Sunday afternoon. Those are happy memories.
I was born on March the 21st, 1906 in Forest Park, where the farmer's market is now. I moved to Hapeville in 1926 after my marriage to Marie Hammond. About 1924, before my wife and I were married, we decided to ride over to the airport. There was an old colored man lived out there, and we made some pictures sitting on the back of his two-horse wagon with 2 feet hanging out. Friends of ours were with us, Buck Walter and his girlfriend, Opal Hutchinson. There was nothing but a racetrack over there and a farmer's house and a garden and a place to play baseball games. We was over there one day when Doug Davis flew in and landed. This may have been his first flight into where the airport is now. Doug was doing some barnstorming, I guess you would call it. He would fly people over College Park, Hapeville, and East Point for $1.50 a trip. I never did fly with Doug, but I did fly with Beeler Blevins. Blevins' machinist came over to the store one afternoon and said, "Rufus, can you get off for about an hour? We're going to fly around Stone Mountain and take some pictures. Come on now." We didn't have any place to sit, had to lay down on the floor. But we took off and flew around the mountain twice and again made pictures of those carvings that had been cut in the mountain. I had to buy a car to drive back and forth to work. I bought a T-model Ford from Mr. Claude Whaley in East Point. It was my first automobile. I never will forget. I think it was $350. Mary and I were dating at the time. We drove over to the airport. Mary and I were married in 1926 and bought a lot on Custer Street for $300. 1 year later, we built our first house. It was brick. We built it from about $3,000. Today, it would cost about $40,000, I imagine. Later on, we bought a lot on Old Jonesboro Road and decided we would build over there. Mr. Emmett Hood built the house for us. Mr. Vaughn at the Vaughn at Lumber Company stood good for me until I could pay him back. Sold it in 1961. When I got out of high school, I came to Hapeville and worked for Rogers Grocery Store. The A&P Tea Company decided to open up a store in Hapeville, and they asked me to be the manager. They opened up in 1925, and I stayed with them until they closed. Mr. Brown, who lived on Central Avenue, took these pictures. I'm standing in the middle of the door. My brother Bill was working with me, just two of us in the store. You might call it a two-man store, but we grew and grew, and finally we got a little bigger store. We didn't have a meat department in the little store. When they made it bigger, they put in a meat market. Mr. Evans opened up the meat market in our store. Some of the people in this picture are Troy Welch, Morris Smith, Dan Landers, Tony Pierce, Ray Bryant, myself, and two or three more I can't account for. Miller's Restaurant was on the corner of Fulton and Central Avenue. We were right next to them. Mr. Umphrey owned both of these lots. As we grew bigger and bigger, they got Mr. Umphrey to enlarge the store. Mr. Wells, up on Central Avenue, was the man that did the brick mason on this store. I started with A&P in 1925, worked with them a total of 38 years until I retired. On my 25th anniversary, Mr. George Stovall, head of personnel, and Mr. Davis, supervisor of the meat department, watched as Mr. Rankin, president of A&P at the time, handed me a check for $25. That was a lot of money then. You could buy a sack of flour for 50 cents. While I was with the A&P company, I was a member of the board of directors for the Hapeville Chamber of Commerce. Those days, we didn't have much to do with, but we did a lot of good things. I would like to say that Sarah Hale was re-elected secretary of the Hapeville Chamber of Commerce board of directors several times. I worked with Sarah very closely, and she is a wonderful person. I would never forget her. I also was on the board of directors, the Tri-City Federal Saving. Mr. B.E. Roebuck was president, and I was vice president. I did all the appraising for several years. Mr. Cantrell, Bradley Porter, Street Carnegie, James Dunn, all of us. We worked together for several years and really did some good work while we were there.
My parents were Mr. and Mrs. T.H. McEwen, and I was born in High Springs, Florida on November the 5th, 1902. My dad worked for the railroad, and the family moved to Savannah from Florida and then moved to Atlanta when I was 4 years old. In 1913, we moved to Hapeville and bought this house on Central Avenue, where I'm still living. After living in Atlanta, Hapeville was just like country. and we were overjoyed and delighted. We had a place to get out and run, had a place for a garden. We didn't have any inside plumbing, but there was a little outhouse out back, and we had a well. We were so happy we didn't miss anything. On the back of the property, there were some apple trees and several peach trees. There were orchards, pear trees in Hapeville at that time, and in the spring, Hapeville was a beautiful place. We had a garden where we raised corn for the pigs. When we first got the pigs, they were running around all over the place. We finally fixed a pig pen, and it was always so much fun to go feed the pigs. My daddy also liked to raise chickens. There were no laws against having animals in your yard then. Almost everyone in Hapeville had their own garden and chickens. We also had a cow, and no one objected when she was tied in the front yard. I have always loved this home. Mr. Sims was our next-door neighbor. He had a great big berry patch in his backyard, and he would put them in cases on the little train called the dummy, would stop in front of his house and pick up the strawberries, take them to town to sell. On the other side of our house, the Methodists had a parsonage. Mr. Joyner was a preacher. His daughter played hooky from school on the 1st of April and was suspended from school for a few days. We children thought that was real funny. When we first came to Hapeville, Mr. and Miss Whitney lived in the big house where the Adams later lived. Mr. Whitney didn't have the newspaper delivered to his house. He liked to go to the post office every afternoon and pick it up. They were real nice people. Both the Whitneys and our family were members of the Presbyterian Church. When it was at the corner of Central and Stewart Avenue, it was a small church. We had Sunday school in the afternoon. Have you ever heard of that? Later, this church building was moved to King Arnold Street and used for the Central Baptist Church. Mr. and Ms. Whitney owned a long strip of land on Fairview Avenue from Central down to and including where the Presbyterian Church now stands. After Mr. Whitney's death, Ms. Whitney gave the land to the Presbyterian Church, and they built their new church. The name of Fairview was changed to Whitney Avenue in honor of Mr. and Ms. Whitney. After his death, Ms. Whitney had a little modern house at the corner of Central and Whitney. That's when the Adamses moved into the big house. Mr. Sims had the berry patch, was one of the first settlers in Hapeville. Sims Street is named in his honor. When Myrtle Street was opened up, it went through the property. That was Mr. Sims' berry patch, so the street was named after his youngest daughter, Myrtle. Later, she married John Nesbitt, the son of Dr. Nesbitt. I have always liked to sew and do embroidery work. I used to make doll clothes, design hats for dolls to wear, so when it came time for me to work, I picked a job that I was familiar with. I went to work for the American Hat Company in January 1920. It was located on Trent Avenue. I did all kind of work there, kept time, inspected, worked in various departments. I worked there for 49 years until they went out of business in April 1969. I loved every minute that I worked there. I could get hats wholesale from the company. When I wanted to give my mother and my aunt something special, I would buy them a hat. I still have boxes full of hats up in the attic. I would be glad to give you some of them for a display at the depot. I really would.
I was born July 11th, 1903, in Cherokee County, Georgia. We came to Hapeville in the summer of 1917. We lived on Georgia Avenue, about two doors down from the grammar school up on College Street. We had a 5-acre farm that is part of the airport. Well, that's true, airport. I remember back when they didn't have any airport. The airport property was the old Candler racetrack where the present Ford company is now. It was all wood, absolutely wood, and a sawmill was there. They could haul huge logs by rail and saw those logs up. Back in those days, my father was a mail clerk on the Southern Railroad. The railroad ran under the Central Georgia, which is now Highway 75. The city limits of Hapeville was at the corner of Central of Georgia Railroad and where the old Southern Railroad went under Central. There was a little town called Hassville there. There were very few paved roads back in those days. Central Avenue was paved and maybe part of Stewart Avenue into Atlanta. But in the state of Georgia, there were no paved roads whatsoever outside of Fulton County. When you got out of Fulton County, you got on a dirt road, and the only way you could travel was on a train. General Motors, Ford, and Chrysler had no assembly plant in Atlanta. They shipped the automobiles from Detroit down to Ponsilian Avenue, shipped them in boxcars. They put about 6 cars already assembled, and they would unload them, and the farmers would get into the cars and drive them off. There were no filling stations. When you wanted to buy gasoline, you parked your car in front of the drugstore and called the clerk in the drugstore to come out there. He hand pumped 1, 2, 3, or 4 gallons, whatever. He'd pump as much gasoline as you needed. When my father bought the land that joins the airport, someone had some mules. Back in the property was an old spring. Those mules would run, they would just run back and forth, and one day a mule ran off and got on that spring. He got into soft mud and got stuck in the mud. They had to get special crew to hoist him up and get him out. In 1926, my father built our house on Stewart Avenue, just below North Avenue. That's where we lived, and we call it our old home place. The house was sold several years ago. The Baptist Church, the Stone Church, was built in 1924. My father-in-law was the superintendent of construction on that church. I now remember the church when it was a little wooden structure. I entered Georgia Tech in 1922, and I was a professional engineer. My license is still in effect to this day. After I graduated from Georgia Tech, I practiced engineering and did important engineering work. One important project I did in those days was the Fox Theater. I was the engineer on the Fox. I worked for 18 months on the design of the Grady Hospital. I have done engineering work in practically every state in the United States, from Maine to California. I was one of the engineers that designed work on the Hartsfield International Airport, the one built in 1962. Many of the important buildings over there on the airport property. When my wife and I married. The first house we lived in was at the corner of Central Avenue and Virginia Avenue. The filling station wasn't there then. The old-fashioned house was on the corner, and they moved it down three doors below when they built the filling station. When we married, we had three rooms. We didn't have gas, and we didn't have electricity, and we paid $15 a month rent. Some of the happiest days of my life were spent in Hapeville, and I looked back many happy, wonderful memories of those days, and that's all.
I was born October the 20th, 1919, at Millport, Alabama. I came to Hapeville October the 29th, 1940, when I was based at Candler Field with the Army Air Corps. The fair city of Hapeville, Georgia, is a very historical city for many reasons. For one reason, Hapeville borders the great Hartsfield International Airport. Since it has been nearly half a century since the Air Force units have moved from this airport, most people do not even realize that the Army Air Corps had an important part in its history during World War II and even before that era. So in honor of those brave airmen, and in order to perpetuate the part they played in the history of this era, this record is made. This record does not give all the history in detail about the part played in the Army Air Corps at this airport. However, it does give some information about its history. Before and during World War II, the following Army Air Corps squadrons were based at Candler Field. The Air Base Squadron served their own aircraft, as well as all transit military aircraft passing through the base. The 30th Observation Squadron was formed and organized at this same air base in 1940, which was about a year before the United States entered the war. This very elite squadron was still based there when the Japanese bombed Pearl Harbor. They sunk most of our Pacific Naval Fleet. The first night after Pearl Harbor attack, a comrade and I stood guard to protect several railway tank cars which were loaded with aviation fuel to be used in our 047 type airplanes. These tank cars were on a sidetrack on the Central of Georgia Railroad about two blocks west of the Hapeville Railroad Depot. One day we were practicing landings in a two-seated single-engine plane, and I was seated behind the pilot. And after the third touchdown, I noticed the plane was not aligned with the runway, and we were getting close to the ground. I kept hearing bumping noises, but couldn't figure out what it was. And just before we crashed, the pilot pulled the plane up. I was really concerned, to say the least. A few minutes later, on the plane intercom, I asked, "Say, what was the trouble?" The pilot replied, "The rudder controls were jammed. Thought I'd never bump them loose." Then he added, "The same thing happened on this same plane yesterday." I thought to myself, how stupid can you get? And here we are with one more landing to make. The citizens of Hapeville were unusually nice to the men of the Army Air Corps based in the area. These airmen, who were a long distance from their homes, were made to feel very welcome in Hapeville. The Hapeville churches were good to make special efforts to make the airmen based at Candler Field welcome. Every Sunday evening, a group of fine Christian young ladies went to the airport to sing before the airmen. Many of these soldiers attended Sunday school and worship services at the various Hapeville churches. Several of the airmen later married some of these fine young Christian ladies of Hapeville. I married Anita Mann, who grew up in Hapeville and who did her wearing on this famous rock. The airman who served many years ago at this airport will always have a very warm place in their heart for the city of Hapeville, Georgia. When these fine airmen mixed and mingled with Hapeville people, they knew they had something worth fighting for, and they all gave a good account of themselves doing just that with great honor and pride. these men liked Hapeville so well that quite a number of them came back to Hapeville as civilians after the war ended and took up careers in civil aviation with airlines operating out of this great airport. The airmen who were once based at this important airport and all military personnel will be pleased and honored to know that the Hapeville Historical Society did not forget them in preparing a record of the history of Hartsfield International Airport.
I was born in Atlanta at 100 Stevens Street, which is now Shelton Avenue, on September 1, 1913. I lived in a shotgun house, three rooms long and one room wide. We had running water, but had to run next door to get a bucket full. We also had outside plumbing, had a path. We moved to Hapeville when I was 11 years old. We had a cow. My daddy, my brother, and I walked that cow from Atlanta to Hapeville down Old Stewart Avenue. I will never forget that because it took us all day. We moved down on 90 Fulton Avenue in Hapeville, which was a dirt street. There weren't many paved streets in Hapeville at that time except Central Atlanta and Virginia Avenue. Mr. Sims, who lived on North Central Avenue, had a sanitary company, a big, great big tank truck. He would go around collecting refuse from the houses that didn't have plumbing and then go dump it someplace. He would put out another bucket for you to fill up for the next trip. Well, that's the way it was. I went to College Street School, started in the fourth grade and went through the seventh grade. They didn't have Russell High School at that time. I had to go to Fulton High School down on Washington Street. When I was going to College Street School, Robert Lampkin, a Methodist preacher, was principal. Some of us got a whipping nearly every day, and he used to tell us when he got ready to whip us, "Son, I hate to do this because it hurts me worse than it does you." And I said, "Well, we'll have turnabout fair play. You give me the switch." One day he was going to switch three of us boys, and we were a lot bigger than he was, so we took him and pulled his coat off, pulled his shirt tail out in the back, tied a great big knot in it, hung him out the window, and let the window down on the knot and left him hanging there. We thought we were doing something big, but the fire department had to come over there and get him down. We were put on probation for 3 months. That's what made it so bad. Being on probation, we couldn't go to the ball game on Saturday because we had to go to City Hall at 2 o'clock and report. That's what we had to do. Well, while still in school, I went to work for Chapman Drugstore on Central Avenue, riding that bicycle and delivering. There was one woman that lived down on Virginia Avenue named Mrs. Anderson. She had to have a Coca-Cola every morning at 9 o'clock. She didn't want it in a paper cup. She wanted it in a glass. And in the wintertime, icicles would be hanging off my hand where that thing had splashed out, riding the bicycle with one hand. She would take the Coca-Cola in the house and drink it while I stood out on the porch till she got through so I could bring the glass back, and that was for a nickel. That Coca-Cola would be delivered for a nickel. I remember another time when I was riding my bicycle down on Cherry Street to deliver some milkshakes. I hit a hole with my bike and spilled them things. So I stopped and went up in somebody's yard and filled them full of water and carried them up there and knocked on the door. When the man came back and said, "Them things are mighty sweet," I said, "Well, that's the way Chapman Drugstore makes them." Back in those days, we had a swimming pool here. They called it Appling Swimming Pool, way off on Brown Mill Road, and it was a long way down there to walk. Us boys found a wash hole down on the Southern Railroad track where the water came under the railroad and had a big culvert pipe. We would scoot down that pipe and fall out into the water. The water was about 10 feet deep in that hole. We called it the slide because we could slide down through that pipe. Perry and myself, the Stevenson boys, Kirkland boys, and a bunch of boys would go down there and go in the nude. Trains would come by and wave at us, and we would just keep on swimming and jumping in the water. Of course, the train went on by. They didn't know who we were, and we didn't know who they were, and didn't care much in them days. Around Hapeville then, we had an A&P store and a Rogers store, up on Central Avenue. The doors on that Tri-City Hardware store today are the same doors that was on Rogers Grocery Store. Sunshine and Albert Wilder live next door to us, and they used to get their water at my mother's house. Albert and I made an extension on the water pipe back there and bent it over, and that's where we'd take showers. Sunshine would wait until everybody else got through and went in the house, then she'd take her shower. Years later, I got married. Married a girl named Frances Hand from South Georgia. We moved up on Central Avenue next to the Wells home. Then we moved to Evans Drive. In 1940, we had a snow about 10 or 12 inches deep out in that front yard. That was the heaviest snow ever recorded in this part of the country in my time. We built an igloo and had fun playing in the snow. We lived in that house for 2 or 3 years, paid $4 a month rent. All we had was a shell, but it was home and kept us in the dry. I went to work for Delta Airlines in 1951, and 2 years later, we moved to Florida. Then we came back to Hapeville in 1965, because that's where my roots are. When you live in a town as long as I've lived in this one, it's hard to get away from it, and Hapeville hasn't changed too much. It's just gotten smaller.
The Hapeville Historical Society sincerely thanks these five people for letting their memories live again, recalling the time when happiness was. They are helping preserve Hapeville's history for the many generations who will follow them.
Let the memory live again.
When was the last time you saw a horse and buggy? To many of us, it's been quite a while, but it still brings back memories of days long past. The early filling stations were for horses and hay instead of autos and unleaded. Wells were Hapeville's only source of water until the water system was installed in the teens. There was a public well at the north end of the depot for both people and horses. The dummy train contributed in great measure to the growth of Hapeville. Later, streetcars helped continue the steady growth of our city. For many years, most Hapeville citizens kept chickens, cows, and even pigs on their property. Neighborhood backyard stores were also available for basic necessities. Growing up in Hapeville was a happy small-town experience, and automobiles were replacing the horse and buggy. Our guests for this program recall their many experiences and memories of growing up in Hapeville.
This is the voice of Edith Calloway. Helen has laryngitis and asked me to read her oral history. I will read this in first person as if it were Helen speaking. I was born September the 1st, 1912, in Mountain View, Georgia, and moved to Hapeville when I was 4 years old. Our house was located where Rhodes Furniture Store is now. My father owned the land where the Catholic Church is and went on down to the Little Southern Railroad, which is now I-75. Later, we moved to the other end of Central Avenue and lived in what is known as the Sims House. It is one of the oldest houses in Hapeville. My father bought it so there would be plenty of room for my grandparents to live with us, and it was a place where all the children in the neighborhood loved to come and play. We all had such fun when we were growing up in Hapeville. One of the highlights every week was going to the Baptist Children's Home. They would let the town children come to the movies on Saturday nights. We would be so excited. We would go home talking about what we thought was going to happen the next week. The movies always ended up with a cliffhanger. At that time, Hapeville had what they called a constable. They just had one policeman. He would always come with us to the gate at the children's home and see us across Central Avenue. He would tell us to go straight home so our people wouldn't be worried about us. Since there weren't any movies on this side of Atlanta at that time, we thought that was very considerate for the home to let the outside children come for the movies. Hapeville is still a charming place to live, but it was especially wonderful for all of us growing up as children. My family moved back to South Central Avenue, and in 1928, my father went into business for himself. He had been in the grocery business practically all of his adult life, but he had always worked for someone else. He was just getting established when the Depression came, but he weathered the Depression, and we had some exciting times and made some special friends. The store was Walker's Grocery Store on Central Avenue. My father would go out and take orders and come back in and fill the orders and deliver them. He was always glad to do any other service that he could for any of his customers. Sometimes he would take a piece of material and match the thread for some young mother who had small children who couldn't get away from home and didn't have the right color of thread. It was rough during the Depression. It will always stay in my mind. I remember seeing grown men come in the store because they couldn't pay their bills, and tears would spill down their cheeks. My father would say to them, "As long as there are goods on these shelves, you will be looked after. You have been my good friends and customers, and we will go through this together." That was a time that took a lot of cooperation. The city was very concerned about the unfortunate, and many was the time when my father would open the store to get food for a family that had nothing in their house. Usually, one of the policemen from the city would come and take the food to the people who were in such desperate circumstances. My father retired in 1940, and he and my mother traveled a lot, but they were always delighted to get back to Hapeville. I can hear my mother say now, "We are back in the garden spot of the world," when they rode into the city limits. On June 25, 1957, my mother and father celebrated their golden wedding anniversary at the Hapeville Music Clubhouse. This was one of the last occasions held there before it burned. We had a number of people with the airlines who were good friends and customers. Johnny and Jane Keitel, Slim and Daisy Thomas, several with American Airlines. I can't remember their names now. They all loved to live in Hapeville. Some of them transferred back as many as three times and were always real happy to get back to Hapeville. I remember one time when something went wrong at the airport with the ground lights, or landing lights, I don't know what they called them. Daisy Thomas was real concerned about Slim coming in without the landing lights. All of their friends went over and turned on their car lights, and Slim made a safe landing. When I was 4 years old, I started to the old Presbyterian church on the corner of Central and Stewart Avenue. Mrs. H.K. Moss was my first Sunday school teacher. The church had a bell that was given to it by the Arnolds and Kings, and that was another thing I remember. On Sunday morning, as we were going to Sunday school, we could hear the church bell ringing as well as the bell at the Georgia Baptist Children's Home. Those were beautiful sounds on Sunday mornings. About 1922, the Presbyterian Church was built on Whitney Avenue. Mrs. L.G. Whitney donated the property. At one time, she cut her vacation short to save money so she could have restrooms put in the church. She also took her rosewood piano out of her own home and donated it to the church. The piano is still being used at the church. She also gave the communion table and chairs to the church. She was a very generous person. The book club in Hapeville was composed of 12 members. Each one contributed a book at the beginning of the year, and at the end of the year, we were supposed to have read 12 books. Some of the 12 members originally were Floyd Scraggs, Manita Hutchinson, Elizabeth Smith, Mina Paula, Roma Jefferson, Ruth Askew, and Louise Leach. I can't remember the original 12, but this club is still continuing. Another club that was most enjoyable was the Antique Club. I don't think we limited the membership. It was for people who were interested in collecting antiques. We had about 20 members. One time, we had a reception at Georgia Parker's home, and some of our old school teachers came along with many other people. The main purpose of the club was getting people together who were interested in collecting antiques and going on tours of antique shops. This carved rosewood footstool belonged to Mrs. Whitney and was given to one of the club members. The Clark and Coates spool chest, originally used to display spools of thread, was found in a general merchandise store in Woodstock, Georgia. Possibly some of you may have warmed your bed with a foot warmer similar to this one. It was found in Blairsville, Georgia. Ida Bobo, Edith's mother, found this pincushion, and later a floral was made from it. It originally belonged to Emma Huey Humphreys, Miriam's grandmother.
Even though I was born in Mountain View, Dr. Nesbitt of Hapeville delivered me. He brought all of us children into the world. His home was at the corner of College and Perkins Streets. It was a beautiful old home. There is a business there now. Dr. Nesbitt was greatly loved by everybody in Hapeville and in Mountain View. Whenever anyone needed a doctor, they would always call Dr. Nesbitt. My husband was Carlos Mason Sisson. He was always known as Fritz. That nickname always stuck with him. We built a house on Atlanta Avenue, and we lived there for 7 years. We finally found this place at 480 Radar Street after the airport began to inch in on us. For a while, we lived on Wheeler Street because there was nothing much for sale in Hapeville at that time. Fritz was assistant postmaster in Hapeville for many years. He had been postmaster for 5.5 years at the time of his death. Growing up in Hapeville was a wonderful experience, and I want to spend the rest of my life here.
I am Edmund Brown. I was born in the West End section of Atlanta, January 22, 1917. That was a cold winter. I've noticed on TV weather programs that some of the records for the coldest days were in the days and weeks following my birth. My family moved to Hapeville about 1920 when my brother Jody and I were just babies. I thought I came to Hapeville in primitive times, but by the time we got there, the city had electricity, water, and sewage. We moved to this little house at 74 South Fulton Avenue. World War I had just ended, but it was still the topic of conversation while I was growing up. 60 years later, the airport has taken over the lot and the house to build the loop road, but part of South Fulton Avenue remains. Hapeville was connected to Atlanta by railroad, auto, and streetcar. The streetcar line came by the depot and ended at College Street School, which Jody and I attended. Later, we rode the streetcar to Russell High in East Point. Dr. Frank Wells played an important part in my life as I was growing up. He was our family doctor and friend, and my mother was his medical secretary for many years. His son, Frank Jr., was one of my best friends. We would ride around with Dr. Wells as he made house calls. In fact, that's the way I learned my way around Atlanta. Dr. Wells would take Frank Jr., Jody, and me on trips around the state. I remember once as we arrived at Helen, Georgia, in his Buick, Dr. Wells said, "Well, I drove all the way up here without having to change gears." We made a lot of trips to the mountains as I was growing up. This scene was made in the Chattahoochee River near Helen, Georgia. At the left is Forrest Gerard, Runette Gerard, Brooksie Wells, Dr. Wells, Nettie Adamson, Verita Brown, my mother, Zach Adamson, and Mrs. Gerard's daughter, Jeanette. Frank Wells, Jr. is standing in front of Mrs. Gerard. I'm not in the picture because I had the camera. With the airport nearby, Jody and I didn't have far to look for heroes. One of these was Johnny Keitel, shown here beside his Pitcairn mail wing about 1929. Jason Lowry's barbershop was located only a few yards from the Methodist Church near the depot. That's me in the nearest chair, and Jody is in the other chair. A tray full of magnesium powder was set off to make the flash for this picture, and the room was filled with smoke from the powder after the photo was taken. After attending College Street School for 7 years, I graduated in 1930. I was valedictorian of my class. This picture was made in the same spot 58 years later. The trees have gotten older along with me. Then I entered Russell High in East Point. Students attended Russell from many miles around, and I made many good friends there. It was truly one of the highlights of my life. Many of these classmates still live in the area, and we get together at least once a year. Having grown up near the airport, it was probably inevitable that I would someday work there. On June 26, 1940, I went to work for Eastern Airlines in the operations department. I worked with Eastern for 6 years, all during World War II, and had many interesting experiences. I worked at five different stations, and at Chattanooga, I met and married a beautiful redhead named Connie Hudson. We now have two children, four grandchildren, and two great-grandsons. After leaving Eastern, I worked for Southern Salt Service for about 30 years. During that time, I edited the newsletter for the company, and after I retired, I was commissioned to write two books, one about the history of the company and one about the history of the trade association of which Southern Salt Service was a member. Another book I've written is about growing up in Hapeville. Talk about memories. One of the hobbies which I've enjoyed is building model airplanes. In this scene, you can see Lindbergh's Spirit of St. Louis at the top, then a Cessna 150. Next is a replica of the Wright brothers' famous flyer, the plane that made the first flight at Kitty Hawk in 1903. Everybody has probably by now recognized the trim little red and black plane at the bottom. Of course, it's Doug Davis's Travel Air Mystery Ship, in which he won the Thompson Trophy in Cleveland, Ohio in 1928. This model is now on display at the Hapeville Depot Museum. Although it's been a long time since I have lived here, I have fond memories of growing up in Hapeville and have always considered Hapeville a big part of my life.
I was born July the 2nd, 1914, in Mystic, Georgia, Irwin County. I lived most of my childhood in South Georgia. I moved to Hapeville in October of 1933 and lived on Atlanta Avenue with my aunt, Mrs. L.A. Waters, shown with my mother. I lived with her until I married Harold F. Rattery of College Park. The house behind the wagon is the old Methodist Church parsonage on Atlanta Avenue. I met my husband on a blind date. A friend of mine introduced us, and we dated quite a while and got married on September the 14th, 1936. Immediately after we got married, we lived on the corner of Spring Haven and North Avenue, where my first child was born. We moved to another house on Spring Haven Avenue. Some of our neighbors on Spring Haven were Mr. and Mrs. L.C. McElroy, Mr. and Mrs. Top Ellington, Mr. and Mrs. Glenn Kirkland, Mrs. Louise Stillman, and Mr. and Mrs. Ralph Murphy, Mr. and Mrs. Jack Buchanan. In all, we lived in Hapeville approximately 30 years. We sold our home to Ramada Inn and moved to our present address. Our hearts and roots are still in Hapeville, and we still return for all of our activities. Harold and I have two daughters, Ann and Beth, who attended North Avenue Grammar School and graduated from Hapeville High School. Ann has been employed with Delta Airlines for 22 years. Beth taught school for a number of years and now is a homemaker. Beth has four children. When I came to Hapeville, I immediately moved my church membership to the Hapeville United Methodist Church, and I have been a member there for over 50 years. I taught in the junior department for several years. In 1964, I was chairman of the Doris Smith Circle. The women shown in this picture are Miriam Smith, Dot Allen, Elizabeth Rattery, Minnie V. Baker, Jeanette Russell, Mina Paula, Frances Thompson, Alma Pope, Violet Goley, Lucille Leathers, and Daisy Needham. Over the years, I have been a member of the Hapeville Woman's Club, in which I held all of the offices, including president, for 2 years. The newly elected 5th District officers for the 1982 were Sarah Kate Harris, Ora Jean Gunning, Mrs. McGover Landis, Lula Powell, Elizabeth Rattery, Annabelle Matheny, and Tony Baxter. Hapeville has many civics clubs, and I was active in the Home Demonstration Club and Exchange Club. Both clubs have service to others as their objective. I served as worthy matron several times in the Order of the Eastern Star, Hapeville Chapter Number 179, and was Grand Officer in 1978 of the State of Georgia. The order is dedicated to charity, truth, and loving kindness. Harold was District Grand Deputy of Eastern Star in 1984, and I served as a special grand page. Harold and I celebrated our golden wedding anniversary on September the 10th, 1986, in the Fellowship Hall of the United Methodist Church. It was an honor to be chosen Hapeville's Woman of the Year in 1966, and Geddes Rosser was Man of the Year because of his work in Hapeville High School Athletic Association, Boy Scout work, and for his long hours as volunteer worker at the South Fulton Hospital Emergency Room. A special honor was given me as past matron of Hapeville's Eastern Star Chapter to present and dedicate the Freedom Light. The Eastern Star is no part of the ancient order of Masonry, but we are bound by the closest ties. The Freemasons have strived for freedom since the beginning of this country. On behalf of these two organizations, I dedicated this light, a symbol of freedom, given with love and devotion, with a plaque which reads 1776 to 1976. This light presented to the city of Hapeville, September the 21st, 1980, and dedicated to the spirit of freedom by the Eastern Star and Masonic bodies of Hapeville. As we placed it, it was our desire and hope for everyone who passed this way that its bright gleam may be a source of inspiration and encouragement in the great moral teachings of these fine orders. I would like to close with this poem written by the late Dewey H. Wallstein, past Grand Master of the Masons in Georgia. Let there be light. Let there be light in the soul of man, the vision that will bless our beloved land. Where there is hate, strife, and despair, let there be light must be our prayer. Let there be light in every heart, at home, at work, on the busy mart, to all who yearn for peace and love. Let divine love shine from above. Let there be light that error we may see and proclaim for truth its victory. Harold and I have always loved Hapeville, and we appreciate being asked by the Hapeville Historical Society to participate in the Society's Oral History Project.
I am William Clyde Norton, better known as Clyde. I was born February the 3rd, 1908, at Grady Hospital in Atlanta, Georgia. My late wife, Ruth, was born in Butts County, Georgia, on July the 12th, 1905. She came to Atlanta in 1926 and lived on Mill Street with her cousin. I will ask my son, Gene, to tell the story of our lives. Gene will be doing the talking.
Ruth and I met while working at the Capital City Chair Company. I ended up in the hospital with a ruptured appendix. Back then, this was very serious. Ruth had collected money to send me flowers. After I found that she was instrumental in taking up the money for the flowers, I kept asking her for a date. She wouldn't give me one for a long time. She said she didn't want to go out with that old redhead. That was me. After about a year of courtship, we tied the knot on June the 2nd, 1928. When we got married, Ruth was working as a billing clerk for Sears Roebuck, and I was working at High Point Chair Company. Our first child, Jean, was born while we lived on Lillian Street in Atlanta. Miriam, our second child, was born while we lived on McDonough Boulevard across from the federal prison. We moved to Hapeville in 1932. We first lived on Fulton Avenue in one of those little houses next to Josephine Wells Grammar School. From there, we moved to Margaret Street. There was a streetcar track behind the backyard, and it went all the way to Atlanta. It was pretty good transportation. Beauty of it was, it only cost a dime to make the trip. Some of our neighbors on Margaret Street were Dr. Otto, the Fulgems, Burks, the McElhannons, and the Smiths. Down the street were the Creasons and the Harps, and next to them was I.W. Taylor. He raised rabbits and sent them all over the world. They also had a little grocery store. One year we had a lot of snow while living on Margaret Street. Ruth and I had a sled, and we played and played in the snow. Jean went to College Street School at first, but later when Miriam got old enough, they both went to North Avenue School. We were living on Margaret Street when World War II broke out. The city of Hapeville set up a civil defense unit and an auxiliary police force. I was appointed chief of the police force. Our duty was to see that all lights were out after dark. The police drove without any lights. All cars were required to have black covers over their headlights at night to keep the lights from showing. There were lots of other problems that would come up, and we were responsible for looking after them. Some of the men that were in the auxiliary police force were Assistant Chief E.E. Howington, and Henry Heary, W.H. Hobbs, A.E. Roth, J.G. Hudson, W.G. Jones, J.R. Roberts, W.W. Oak, M.L. Babb, James L. Taylor, C.L. Welch, Bob Drew, H.W. Hoddle, James W. Taylor, Curtis Steed, Royston Settles, and Glenn Jefferson. Shortly thereafter, in the early days of World War II, we moved from Margaret Street to 809 North Central Avenue. It was from here that I was drafted into the Navy, along with Wimpy Pearson and Doris Abercrombie. Doris is a man's name. You might remember Wimpy Pearson was chief of police at that time. When I went into the Navy, Ruth bought a grocery store from Top Ellington on Central Avenue. It was across the street from where we lived, next to the railroad on Central Avenue. Wimpy Pearson, the chief of police, lived right next door, and on the corner was a garage run by the Callahan brothers. We stayed there about 3.5 years. After I came home from the war, we sold the grocery store on Central Avenue and bought the one on Cherry Street and went to work down there. Harvey Lovechurch was our postman. Now he is a city councilman. Shirley Ivey's kids used to come in the store a lot. Some of the customers that we had on Cherry Street live in my neighborhood now. Just to name some of them, Dave Miller, Jack Henry, Perry Hudson, Tom Florence, Billy and Frank Coggin, James and Jeanette Russell, and Howard Jackson. Jay Sumner's mother and Dr. Durwood Kaysen lived just across the street from the store. Dr. Durwood Kaysen was in the store nearly every day, and he is still one of my very dearest friends. We had a lot of customers in the Fairfax subdivision. I delivered groceries over there and to a lot of houses on Landers Road. There was a black settlement close to Atlanta Avenue and Cherry Street, and I also delivered groceries to them. Even after they moved out of Hapeville, they kept coming back to the store for their groceries. Bodie, my grandson, used to help me. Ruth taught Sunday school for the 8-year-old girls for many years at the Hapeville First Baptist Church, and I was a member of the JOY class. While our kids were in school, we were real active in PTA. We had all kind of carnivals, and we made a lot of money. Ruth was grade mother for many, many years. Being a member of the Masonic Lodge for over 59 years and having already received my 50-year pin is one of the things that I am proudest of. I also had the opportunity to go through Eastern Star. I was worthy patron at the same time Ruth was worthy matron. This was a wonderful treat for us both. Some of the members of the Eastern Star were Aline Hughes, Mrs. Pete Arnett, Mrs. Turner, Mr. and Mrs. I.W. Taylor, Mrs. Blaylock, Evelyn Lewis, Mr. and Mrs. Abercrombie, Louise Leach, and Neva Settles. Ruth devoted much time to this organization and held many offices. In the Historical Society Depot, there is a picture of the charter members of the Hapeville Lions Club hanging on the wall. I am proud to be a charter member. I think at this time we have only one charter member actively working in the Lions Club, and that is Bob Weldon. When the Tri-City Coin Club was organized over 20 years ago, it was my pleasure to have been instrumental in its beginning. We now meet in the Hapeville Depot. The dress that Ruth wore when she was chosen as senior citizen in 1976 is on display in the Hapeville Depot. We have plaques that were presented to us from the Hapeville Recreation Department. The Pleasant Hours Group selected me as Mr. Personality in 1974 and in 1976, and Mr. Hapeville in 1982 and 83. Our son and daughter gave us a party for our 25th wedding anniversary at the Woman's Club on Central Avenue in Hapeville. This was the same building that was later used as a day nursery and blew up from a gas leak explosion. Many people were killed. We lived on Central Avenue across from the little store we used to operate until 1983. Then we moved to 3427 Old Jonesboro Road in Hapeville. It used to be the Mike Lucas House. This is where I live now, right up the street from my son, Gene. On behalf of my deceased wife, Ruth, and myself, I wish to express our thanks to the Hapeville Historical Society for making this presentation. It has always been a pleasure living in Hapeville, and I cherish all of my Hapeville friends.
The days of the horse and buggy have long since faded away. Wagons like this have also disappeared, except for those in museums. The little pedal car has been replaced by a sleek, aerodynamic sport coupe. Childhood days have also speeded up, as has modern transportation. The memories of days long past are happy ones, and we are thankful we grew up in the land of the free. The Hapeville Historical Society thanks these four individuals for allowing us to share in their rich heritage of days gone by. By keeping alive our nostalgic yesterdays, we are better able to cope with the changes of today and the challenges of tomorrow.